If you want to take your Bibles out and turn to the Gospel of John. John chapter 4. John chapter 4, we're going to read today verses 1 through 26. This is Jesus with the Samaritan woman at the well there. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord heard of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his flocks and herds?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he." That's where we'll stop today. We live in a place and time that is deeply divided. Where we are right now, at this moment and in this place, there's all kinds of divisions around us. There's a lot of people who are at odds with one another. And there's all these divisions. There's a lot of political divisions. Especially right now, we've come through a pretty contentious presidential election. Lots of tempers have flared, and there's lots of people who really hated the opposite opponent. And there were a lot of angry words spoken. There's been a lot of protests, a lot of riots even. We're very deeply divided when it comes to politics, when it comes to the direction of our country and who should lead it. A lot of divisions there. But we can't just point to the country in politics, which is usually easy to do. We as Christians are very divided too, aren't we? You think about how many different denominations and churches that there are. We're all over the place. We don't get along very well. In fact, if you count all of the different churches out there, there's maybe somewhere in the neighborhood of 35,000 different denominations out there. And there's lots of churches that don't want to be part of a denomination at all. They just kind of want to be in their own corner and do their own thing all by themselves. And we have tons of independents. And then there's Catholics, there's Orthodox, there's Anglicans, thousands of different denominations. We can't really get along very well. And then, of course, there's racial divides. Things have been kind of seemingly escalating recently in that regard. And we have, of course, especially this week, been hearing the news about how there were four black young people who kidnapped and attacked a white person who was mentally challenged. That was in Chicago. And the trial of Dylan Roof is going on right now, who basically opened fire during a Bible study at a black church and killed 9 people there. And he has shown absolutely no remorse about that at all. It's pretty obvious that his intent was to even start a race war. There's a lot of divisions out there, aren't there? We have a lot of people at odds with one another, a lot of people who hate each other and can't get along. Lots of divisions. And we can't just point fingers, we have to look in the mirror too, don't we? There's a lot of people that we don't get along with, and a lot of people that we would not feel comfortable around either. Let's look at this screen here. What does God's law require of us? Christ teaches us this in summary in Matthew 22. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. And once more, can you live up to all this perfectly? No, I have a natural tendency to hate God and my neighbor. We have a natural tendency to be at odds with each other, as well as God, to even hate each other. And again, it's easy to point fingers and to point to people on the news, but we do need to look in the mirror on these things too. You look at verse 7 here and what we just read. It says, then a Samaritan woman came to draw water. Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? Jesus asks for a drink and crosses many divides here. We don't live in this time and place of when Jesus did. But if we did, this would be very shocking of what Jesus did, asking this Samaritan woman for a drink. There's a lot of divides that he crossed by doing that. One of them, Jesus is a single man, and he initiates conversation with a single woman. There is a man who I read about who lived in the Middle East for 40 years, and this is true even today. If you are a man, you do not interact with a woman. That's inappropriate. If you do that, it's kind of taken as flirting or some sort of come on or something like that. And you especially don't with somebody you don't know. Jesus didn't know this woman, and he asks her for a drink. In the Jewish literature at Jesus' time, it says, one should not talk with a woman on the street, not even with his own wife, and certainly not with somebody else's wife, because of the gossip of men. So this is kind of the common knowledge of Jesus' day. You don't do that. You don't cross those lines. That's inappropriate. People are going to get the wrong idea. The second thing, Jesus is in the middle of his ministry where he's going around and preaching and teaching, and he's going to lots of different places, and he's saying, this is who God really is. This is who I am. This is what I'm about. Jesus is kind of this missionary here, And as a missionary, he asks for help instead of giving help. Usually when you're a missionary, you're going to help somebody else. You have something, knowledge or resources, and you're going to help people who are disadvantaged. And so you're going to help somebody else. And here, Jesus asks for something. I'm in need. I need you to help me. Could you help me out by giving me a drink? That's kind of backwards. There's a lot of times when missionaries, in desiring to help people and to bring them the gospel, to assist people when they have needs, they've actually gone in there and pretty much devalued people even as human beings. Like, we have everything and you have nothing, and so it's kind of created an awkward relationship there. But here, Jesus asks for help. And by doing so, Jesus affirms her dignity as someone who is able to give help. Only strong people can help the weak. And so if you are somebody who says, hey, I'm in need, I'm weak, and you have resources right now, Jesus here affirms her as someone who is able to help him in his need. That's weird. That's awkward. A third thing, Jesus is someone who is sinless. And one who is sinless, someone from heaven, engages one who is sinful. There's another divide that is crossed. In Jesus' day, holiness meant being separate from sinners, because you had to be ritually clean to worship God at the temple, to offer sacrifices and to come before him there. And so you had to stay separate from sinners. So you didn't even want to drink out of the same pitcher, jar. They didn't really use cups back then. You didn't want to drink out of the same holder that somebody who is sinful drank out of, because that would make you unclean. And Jesus here, somebody who is sinless, is asking a sinful woman for something to drink. And this woman doesn't have extra cups in a bag here. He would be asking, you know, from your bucket. Could I have a drink out of your bucket? It says she had five husbands, and the guy, not to mention the guy that she was currently with there. And he points it out there, doesn't he? But he doesn't put her down for it. He just calls attention to it. I think that's interesting. We can't ignore sin. That's not good. But at the same time, you know, we're sinners too. It's not our job to make people feel bad about it either. And Jesus, being sinless, he doesn't even do that. Like later in the Gospel of John, you know, let the one who is without sin cast the first stone. Jesus could have cast that stone, and he didn't. And a fourth thing, and this one is maybe the most interesting. A Jew, that's Jesus, engages a Samaritan on Samaritan turf. This is Samaritan country. And Jesus, as a Jew, is engaging her. That's weird at best, if not confrontational even. Samaritans, they were kind of half Jews. This goes back into the Old Testament when there was a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom, and the northern kingdom was conquered by Assyria, and then half of those people were deported, and then other people were brought in, and those people intermarried, and they also mixed in the other gods with them. So Samaritans, they knew the true God, and they kind of worshipped him, but they kind of had a lot of other gods too. And so they didn't really worship the real God in the right way. They were considered unclean. But not just that. There was a lot of political things going on here too. Jews and Samaritans hated each other. They didn't just dislike each other, they hated each other, and they killed each other. Before Jesus was born, the Jews who were in power at that time, this woman here mentions a temple or a mountain where they worship. You know, you Jews worship in Jerusalem and we worship on this mountain. Well, before Jesus, about 100 years before Jesus, there was a ruler at that time who went to this Samaritan mountain and just completely destroyed the Samaritan temple. When Jesus was a young boy, there were Samaritans who went into Jerusalem and desecrated the Jerusalem temple by scattering human bones on the temple grounds there. That is incredibly offensive. That desecrates their holy site by doing that. And not too long after Jesus here, there were some people from in the north of Galilee where Jesus grew up, and they were going to cross through Samaria to go worship at the temple for one of the holidays. And this group of people was attacked by Samaritans, and they were all massacred. They hated each other. A little later on in John chapter 9, when the Jewish authorities were looking to insult Jesus, they say to him, "Aren't we right in saying that you are Samaritan and demon-possessed?" Being a Samaritan was basically equivalent to being demon-possessed. You're demonic. You're not just bad. You're demonic. You're like subhuman. You are pure evil. They hated each other. And many Jews would take the scenic route to avoid passing through Samaria. They would actually take a whole extra day to go around Samaria if they had to go to Galilee from Jerusalem. They would go way out of their way. But look at what it says in verse 4 here, if you have your Bible still open. Now he had to go through Samaria. It says he had to go through Samaria. That's kind of interesting. Not everybody did that. But it says here that he had to. He had to go through, it says in verse 4. Now the Greek word there, it basically says it is necessary. It was necessary for him to go through Samaria. And in the Gospel of John, that word is kind of code for this is what God wants. And Jesus is fulfilling what God wanted him to do. It was necessary. This is what God wanted him to do. God wanted him to cross through Samaria at this time. It indicates divine necessity. Whenever it's used in John, he had to go through. And there's a reason why he had to go through. This woman who came for water needed the living water that was sitting right in front of her. There were lots of people in Samaria, and they needed to hear the gospel too. They needed Jesus too. He had to go through Samaria. Because there were people there who needed him. Jesus asked her for a drink. But like he said, if you knew who was asking you, you would ask him for a drink. And he would give you living water so that you would never be thirsty again. Okay, so you and I, we call ourselves Christians. That means we are followers of Christ. We follow Jesus. And as people who follow Christ, we must be willing to reach across divides like he did. We have to go near people who are different than us out of divine necessity, out of our calling from God. So will you follow Christ into places and to be among people who are different than you. Maybe even people who really don't like you, can't stand you. Maybe even people might even be dangerous to be around them because of your differences. We usually avoid those situations, especially when it involves danger, doesn't it? But considering how Jews and Samaritans didn't like each other, Jesus was taking quite a risk in traveling through Samaria. But would we, for most of us in most of our situations, a lot of it is just uncomfortable, and so we avoid those situations. But we get uncomfortable because we're a little too worldly, aren't we? We're uncomfortable around certain people because maybe we're a little too attached to the worldly designations of people. We think of ourselves a little bit too much maybe by our politics or our clothing or our socioeconomic class or our race or whatever. We identify with the world's categories. A little bit ago, we just responded with, you know, the greatest commandment, to love your Lord, your God, and then to love your neighbor as yourself. When Jesus gave that command to love your neighbor as yourself in Luke, that greatest command to love your neighbor was paired with the parable of the Good Samaritan. And in that parable, a Samaritan risks his own life to stop and help a Jew who was otherwise going to die. If you're familiar with that parable, there's a Jew who is going from Jerusalem to Jericho. He's attacked by bandits. He is left half dead beside the road. And there was a priest who passed by and did nothing. There was a temple assistant who passed by and did nothing. And then there was a Samaritan who came and did everything. We need to be like Jesus. We need to be able to give and receive help from anyone. Only giving help and being unable to receive help, that's called pride. We need to be able to not just give help, we need to be able to receive help too. We need to be able to ask people for a drink of people who are very different than us. By only receiving help and never giving any help, that's called selfishness. We need to be able to both give help and receive it, so that we would be neither proud nor selfish. Be willing to be around sinners. In the Old Testament and in Jesus' day, you were unclean by being around sinners, by even drinking out of the same container as them. Jesus fulfilled all of those laws. It's not like that anymore. Being around sinners doesn't make us unclean. That's not what makes us unclean. We're unclean not by who's standing next to us or what pitcher we drink out of. We're unclean by, according to Jesus, what comes out of our mouth and what comes out of our heart. That's what makes us unclean. In particular, we're unclean when we no longer think sin is sin. When we start saying wrong is right. That makes us unclean. And that person who's maybe the most morally repulsive person in your life, of the person in your circles, maybe that's the person in your life who most needs Jesus right now. Maybe God has put that person in your path for you to reach out to them. dodge political debates to ask spiritual questions. Especially when anxieties are high, both sides of the aisle, whether you're red or blue, anxieties are high, there's going to be these political debates. People are going to put down the other side. They're going to put down each other's candidates, each other's leaders. And there's going to be this moment inside of us where we're going to want to rush to their defense because, you know, we belong to this side. But pick your battles. Pick your battles. If you are going to get excited about something, get excited about Jesus Christ and who He is. That's the side we really belong to. Any political opinions that we have, they come from Jesus Himself, don't they? He's the baseline. He's the bottom line. If we have any other views in addition to that, it comes from that. People don't need to become like us politically. They need Jesus. So why would we be getting rough and tumble about all of these arguments that are up here when really the big matter at hand is down here? It's Jesus, isn't it? The world needs Jesus. People don't need to vote like we do. They don't need to think like we do. They need Jesus. That's the bottom line. Let's pick our battles. Let's not get caught up in these divides that are all around us. Don't be defined by the divides. These are worldly divides. These are not godly divides. And the world puts people into these categories. And unless we're paying attention, we fall into these categories too, and we label each other with these categories. My grandpa grew up in Greece, and especially in that area, the Balkans, this is where a lot of different people come together here. It's a very troubled place. In World War I, especially World War I, the Balkans area of the world is called the powder keg. What happened in the Balkans there actually sparked a world war. And my grandpa, being in Greece, they're very much at odds with the countries around them. So Greece borders Albania, Bulgaria, and Turkey. And he could tell me stories about people from each of those countries and what they did to people in Greece. The atrocities. This is what they did. So one time I just kind of with this notion of forgiveness, the Bible calls us to forgive people, you know. I've just asked him, so, you know, you're not in Greece anymore, you're in the United States now, right? And we're from all different kinds of places around the world, and it's not like it was back home. What if an Albanian moved next door? And would you be able to say hello to him, be friendly to him? And he's like, I think I could. I think I could be nice to an Albanian and be neighbors with them. Okay, what about a Bulgarian? If a Bulgarian moved next door, would you be able to be friendly with a Bulgarian? He said, this one was a little harder for him. I think I could get along with a Bulgarian. Yeah, sure. So what about a Turk? Without skipping a beat, he said, no, never. I could never be friends with a Turk. We're defined too much by these worldly designations. And these worldly designations, they keep us from doing what God wants us to do. Like even to be kind to somebody who's next to you, who lives next to you. Somebody, this is a priest, not just anybody, this is a priest from Serbia talking about Turkish people. I would kill a Turk, but I wouldn't torture them. A priest. I would kill a Turk, but I wouldn't torture them. These designations, these categories that the world puts on us, they keep us from doing what God wants us to do. Let's not be defined by those categories, those labels. Those don't define us. Be defined by the God of all people. There's only one God. There's not a lot of them. And this one God rules all of us. Romans 10:11-14. I think I put that on the screen there. As Scripture says, anyone who trusts in Him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on Him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Anyone, everybody. God calls people from all over the place. We're going to share heaven with these people. We can't be defined by these categories anymore. And I love what it says right after that. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without somebody preaching to them? That's our job. We need to be willing to share the good news with people we might otherwise hate. Be defined by the Christ who saves all who call on Him. He's the one who defines us. Romans 3:21-24. But now a righteousness from God, apart from law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There's no difference. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. We're all sinners. We're all in that same low category. And if we're justified, we're all justified the same way by Jesus. We live in a divided world right now. We live in a world that is defined by worldly categories and worldly labels. We have a huge opportunity here. In a world divided, we have an amazing opportunity to shine Jesus Christ to all different kinds of people. Cross those divides. Show people Christian love. Be like Jesus when He asked that Samaritan woman for a drink. Even if you would otherwise very much disagree with or very much dislike somebody, cross those divides, because everybody needs Christ. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father who is in heaven. Let's bow our heads together now. Our Father in heaven, Lord, in this world that's at odds with one another for all different kinds of reasons, help us to cross those divides like Jesus did, your Son. Help us to cross them too, Lord, so that we would be able to bring your good news to all different kinds of people, because all of us need you together. And we pray, Lord, that we would see people as you see them, not as the world sees them, and that you would give us those eyes. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.